All right, welcome all. This is the beginning of the class on the foundations of computer vision. And everything I'm going to say today, you can find at this address here. And I want to tell you, you know, a little bit, you know, what is computer vision about in the first place. So it has really become a something that consumers use every day now. Not all of you might have this switched on, but you know, you can log into your smartphone by giving your fingerprint, which actually, you know, is an image. It's not acquired by a camera, but there is an image of your fingerprint, and recognizing whether it's truly yours, you know, that would be a by now very simple computer vision task. Or some of you use albums where you can tag people with their names, and then you can just enter the name of that person, and then it does it all automatically for you. You know, that would be the kind of problem which would have been unsolvable or required supercomputers 20 years ago, and now, you know, it's on all of your devices. It is certainly a big topic in industry, where it's often called machine vision. So, for example, in the manufacturing business, which in this country is such an important industrial branch, there is a lot of machine vision. So you have along production lines, you have lots of sensors that make sure that the parts that go into the production, that they correspond to specifications and so on. So here, for example, you know, when you when you buy an expensive smartphone, you want to make sure that all pixels work, and you know, that would be a super trivial task. You also want to make sure there are no scratches on the glass, for example, or fingerprints or so. That's a much harder task. So actually, us humans, we're pretty good at this. So, you know, I take my phone, and if I look at it this way, the display looks perfect. Then I tilt it slightly to hold it against the light, and now and that's a typical thing that we do. So we turn these things slightly and look at them, and in a way we're finding the perfect illumination, and you know, that is not such a trivial thing for a machine. So the way it works in industry is that you then have like 1,000 lights coming on at different times, and you have cameras at multiple angles, and you take all these images together to hopefully have one which has just the right angle to discover that that scratch in the glass, let's say. All right, this is just one example, and you know, there are literally thousands. And this is there's a very rich machine vision industry in Germany, also very, very many companies working in that domain. Yeah, computer vision actually makes life and death decisions also. The example I've used here is from autonomous emergency braking. This used to be, okay, so 10 years ago, or let's say 15 years ago, this didn't exist at all. Then it came into life in the very, very expensive cars. And nowadays, even small cars, even cheap cars, will have that kind of system built in. And well, this is a kind of system that makes a decision, you know, if a child has been running in front of your car or some situation like that. And then the system will go into an emergency braking. And obviously, you want extremely high accuracy in that kind of question. I'm coming back to that. All right, another example I want to give, it's not not quite life and death, but it's very topical. So this is the local newspaper with today's date. And there is an article in there, are kids under 10 immune against COVID? And they're actually looking for 500 kids, not all from Neuenheim, please, and one parent. And it seems that the university now has managed to develop a test with better sensitivity and specificity than existing ones, which allows you to determine if or not a person is immune against COVID. And I'm mentioning it, well, because it's interesting, it's topical, and I'm mentioning it because it is a computer vision problem. So I think it was 2 weeks ago on a Saturday that a colleague from the clinic called me and said they have these images and could we please something do about it? Or he wrote an email. This was on a Saturday. Then I called a few volunteers and we met on Sunday. And the people from my lab, from Anna Kraschuk's lab, have been working on this ever since, sacrificing a lot of evenings and weekends, not me, but you know them. So people like you, the students, just 2, 3 years further in their education, and they've managed to get it to work. And so they've managed to get it to work in the first place, and they're now in the process of scaling this up. And it's not a trivial task, but it's not rocket science either. So I think by the end of this course, you would be in a decent position to actually solve that problem yourself. And I hear a promise, and Alberti will remind me that if we get the permission from the clinic, we will give this very problem to you as an exercise at the end of the semester to see if you can now do it with what you have learned in the course of this semester. And why at the end of the semester and not right now? Well, because in medicine in general, there is a it's not like open source software development. There are huge stakes and concerns about making data open or not, and so on. And I want to give you an example of very open data collection. And all of this has happened just in the past month, actually. It's called LIOS, and it is, by the way, an interesting read. Hopefully not, in the next 3 minutes, because I would like you to listen to me. Here's the data they've been acquiring. They've set up everything. So a computer science, affine medical doctor with his team has been setting everything up in the past 4 weeks. And I find it very interesting. For example, the comorbidities. So I thought, who's going to suffer the most in COVID? I thought it's the people who have a lung problem, a pulmonary problem, but it's not. It's actually those who had a heart and circulation problem beforehand. And this type of data and much more you can find here. And let me just put in the link here anyway, because I've been mentioning it. And since we're talking about this, and then I will, not speak about COVID for a few days, I think, I hope. The last thing I want to show you is something that we've been really busy with the last few weeks. Namely, to set up a platform where people can post data or questions, or where data scientists can offer their help. And then there is a forum where people can post these questions or answers. And well, what was the connection now to this Rhein-Neckar Zeitung article? Well, the connection, I think, is that I said I cannot give you this data right now because, in general, this sharing data in medicine is much harder than sharing it. Than sharing computer science problems. And there's still a little bit a clash of cultures here. And I think the open source software development community is it's an extreme, I would say, success story. So you're going to use very advanced tools this semester. So, for example, to train a deep network. And setting up such a network or optimization procedure, it's still work today. It still requires expertise, but so much less than it used to be. And this is the result of hundreds and thousands of people working together online, on the whole world, from the whole world, working collaboratively on open source projects on GitHub, and you will see some of the latest and greatest in the software development. You'll use it yourself this semester. All right. So remember this autonomous emergency braking system. Schematically, this is meant to be an image here at T minus 10. So in a video, this is the 11 frames ago. This is the current frame, and let's say that using these 11 frames, we want to make a decision: is there a pedestrian, is there a child in front of the car or not? So we have a video stream from the camera that's built into the front of the car. We have a computer vision system, which here is just a box. And then the outcome, in this autonomous emergency braking, the outcome ultimately is a single bit, yeah? Zero or one. One would be yes, there should be emergency braking. Zero means, it's not needed. So let's say, that each of these is the order of a megabyte or a megapixel, which would not be a lot, yeah. So a camera with 1,000 by 1,000 pixels, that's not a lot. So we have something of the order of 10 megabyte here, probably a bit more of raw data, and the outcome is one bit. So that would be an example of an image classification, or if you consider these 11 frames a video, then you could say that's a video classification problem. And the requirements here, and I'm now secretly training you to read my handwriting, and I promised myself to really try harder this semester, okay? The requirements are an extremely low false positive rate. So you do not want to start an emergency braking, with people hitting their restraining belts and the eyes popping out of the head because the car is braking so hard, and there was nothing, it was just a false positive. It's just that the system decided to brake the car even though there was nothing. That makes for very unhappy owners and for very bad reviews, I can tell you. Yeah, so it's important to have a low false positive rate. It's equally important to have a low false negative rate. Every false negative, is a dead or hurt, child or cyclist or pedestrian. So you have extremely high requirements here. In addition, you want this to happen in real time. So it means you need to process, something more than 30 megabyte, probably much more of input per second. And I mentioned this is happening in small cars. So, in your Renault Clio, you don't want a Titan X GPU with all the energy it will eat and so on. So this has to happen on little processing power in the end. And it's very impressive that computer vision is able to do that nowadays. But still, the upshot is that computer vision is a compute-intensive process. And my observation is that if I look at computer vision pipelines, I see I keep seeing the very same algorithms over and over. I've written here only two handful of algorithms are sufficiently efficient. Now, the rest may be nice, the rest may be very appealing theoretically, the rest may be pretty math and great ideas. But it's never going to, work at scale. It's never going to be deployed as a consumer product. It's never going to make it to the computers and smartphones of all of you. And so I think it's really worthwhile to understand these two handful of algorithms in depth. And it is these two handful of algorithms that are combined in complicated pipelines. And as a metaphor here, I've used Lego bricks. From standard Lego bricks, I can, create all these very, very different kinds of things, just, reusing the same building blocks. And we will, in this lecture, we will study a few exemplary pipelines, so a few important application problems, but the focus of the lecture will be on the building blocks themselves. In a former life, I worked in quantum chemistry, where all we had to do was solve a Schrödinger equation, time independent, time dependent. But I was so happy then. Now there were no images, and the computer vision is much cooler to me. But unfortunately, we have no Schrödinger equation in this field. So it's not a single equation that we have to solve, and then all of computer vision is solved. But even so, computer vision is really also a part of computer science, and this is the perspective that I want to take in this class. And the thing that I've skipped over here is a few keywords that you need to know. So if the input is an image and the desired output is just a single pixel, 0, 1, break, don't break, that's a problem of image classification. If the input is an image and the output is one class per pixel, that is a problem called semantic segmentation or pixel classification. If the input is an image and the output is a grouping of these pixels into instances, that's a problem called instance segmentation, a discipline in which Alberto is a world-leading expert in. And I here show you an example from the so-called Cityscapes benchmark, which has been an influential benchmark in recent years. You here see a view of a city, and then so taken from a car. And then you have on the one hand a color coding, like yellow means traffic sign, purple means sidewalk, or this kind of purple means sidewalk, red means human. But if you look closely, then these humans are delineated. It's not just a red mass here, but you see these outlines where one human ends and the next human starts. And this is what instance segmentation refers to. So we don't just want to say this pixel is human, but we want to say this pixel is human, and these pixels together constitute one instance of the humanoid. All right, this is instance segmentation. Then we have pose estimation. If we want to estimate pose, or we have tracking problems. Let me give you beautiful examples. This one here, the first example I reference, is really very, very solid scientific work, but it's also really nice music that they chose. Alberto, did you hear the sound at all? No, okay, because the sound, too bad, because the sound was playing, of course, on my machine. But yeah, okay, I need to switch a different button then. Fine. So you can listen to this offline. And this is a nice example of a problem or a solution to a problem that would have been, completely intractable a few years ago to reach this kind of quality. And now, thanks to deep learning and so on, is quite possible. Or I can show you a video with no sound, which unfortunately opens on the wrong screen. Hold on. There we go. So what we see here is tracking of dividing cells, which can be important for wound healing assays and so on. And this is a result from a few years ago from Martin Schick from my lab. And I always like looking at biological images. I like the complexity in them, I have to say. All right. That ends my introduction. Do you have questions? Raise your hand. Let us have a break, and I'll put on a timer. Let's have a break, and when we come back, I will ask you a few questions to learn a bit more about you, which of the topics you already maybe know something about. And the timer, let me find it, is here. So see you in 5 minutes. And remember, it's important to stand up and stretch and so on. And I will switch off my camera while I do that, and see you in a few minutes. Bye-bye.